Bibles and open them to Romans chapter 3. We shall read the first 8 verses of Romans chapter 3. I'm actually preaching through Romans in the Wednesday chapels, and as I thought about some things going on in the church today in contrast to our conference, I thought I would simply continue where I would have been in our regular consecutive exposition in chapel. Then what advantage has the Jew? Or what is the benefit of circumcision? Great in every respect. First of all, that they were entrusted with the oracles of God. What then? If some did not believe, their unbelief will not nullify the faithfulness of God, will it? May it never be. Rather, let God be found true, though every man be found a liar, just as it is written, that you may be justified in your words and prevail when you are judged. But if our righteousness demonstrates the righteousness of God, what shall we say? The God who inflicts wrath is not unrighteous, is he? I am speaking in human terms. May it never be. For otherwise, how will God judge the world? But if through my lie the truth of God abounded to his glory, why am I also still being judged as a sinner? And why not say, as we are slanderously reported, and as some claim that we say, let us do evil that good may come. Their condemnation is just. Thus far, the inspired holy word of our God. Please be seated. Well, we've gathered this week in God's providence in our conference to commemorate the great event that took place 500 years ago, Martin Luther nailing the theses to the bulletin board, so to speak, at the Wittenberg Church. Wanted to start a discussion that snowballed into the glorious Reformation, the revival of the Church of the Lord Jesus Christ. And as we gather this week, we will examine Luther and some of the essential aspects of his teaching. And then we're going to have 5 sermons on the solas of the Reformation. Truths in which we revel. The truth that demonstrates the sovereign grace of God. Free justification. And the truth that heralds the perseverance of the saints. And as we gather and do this, we do so against a black backdrop of awful defections, not just in the broader evangelical community, but in the Reformation community. About 3 years ago, a man I taught, not here, supposedly converted in prison, an upstanding student, pastor, husband and father, had churches in Virginia and a church plant in North Carolina. On the way to the PCA General Assembly in Greenville, South Carolina, robbed a bank to support his drug habit that he had reverted to. That shatters us. And of course, the news of the last few weeks where a beloved brother in Christ, one used powerfully of the Holy Spirit throughout the world, has fallen into such terrible sin in his life ending. And we can duplicate other stories. And many of us have our faith in these grand doctrines shaken by the reality of these things. Where is this truth of the perseverance of the saints? Is it a myth? Is it false teaching? Every time one of these things occurs, you will hear people say, we thought the Reformed faith might be true, but obviously it isn't. So how do we hold to these distinctives in the midst of such dark news? Well, Paul shows us here in Romans 3, verses 1 through 4, the first part of this section that we read. It's very apropos to this issue. As you know, the first chapter and a half of Romans, Paul has labored to bring first the Gentiles under the indictment of God's law and the condemnation that was theirs, the righteous wrath of God that was coming down on them. Chapter 2, he turns his guns on the Jews in their hypocrisy and self-righteousness, and he comes to a conclusion that their Judaism doesn't save them. And the physical circumcision doesn't save them. And that lays the backdrop for these two questions that Paul anticipates and answers now in these first four verses. And I want to show you from Paul's answers to these questions that the unbelief of covenant members does not nullify covenant privileges or God's faithfulness. The unbelief of covenant members does not nullify covenant privileges and God's faithfulness. And so we're going to consider two things, just those two simple things. The unbelief of covenant members does not nullify covenant benefits, and it does not nullify God's faithfulness. Paul lays out the first point in the first two verses. Then what? You see, he's picking up, all right? He has condemned Jewish externalism. Then what advantage has the Jew? Or what is the benefit of circumcision? Great in every respect. First of all, that they were entrusted with the oracles of God. Now, as Paul begins this answering these series of objections, he's actually taken a bit of a detour. It's a parenthesis. He'll pick back up on this issue in great detail in chapters 9 through 11. But he is in a hurry to lay out the grand doctrine of justification by faith alone and the truths that flow out of that relationship to the Lord God through Christ Jesus. So this is not his immediate destination, but you can think about it. You're driving to Atlanta, and that's your destination, but you stop at a roadside park. It's brief. You're there for a few minutes, and you're on your way. That's what Paul's doing with this particular excursus or digression. He's beginning to deal with this issue of God's promises, God's faithfulness, and the Jews' rejection of Christ. And so he asked this first question: is there any advantage to being a Jew? Is there any advantage to being in the covenant of God? Is there any advantage in the covenant sign of circumcision? Because he says, you could assume from what I've said that there isn't. The Jew and Gentile, there's no advantage whatsoever of the Jew over the Gentile. But he answers this question, first of all, great in every respect. In every way, there are advantages. It would be as if I asked you, do you know any advantages between being born in a middle class family in America or in a mud hut in the middle of Africa? You would say, many in every way. And Paul says that. And then he lists the first one. And it's first, not simply in order. I think it's first in primacy. He says, first of all, that they were entrusted with the oracles of God. First, not just in his list, but first in priority, because this one explains all the others. So we're right back to where we're going to begin at the conference at 1 o'clock, 1:15, with sola scriptura. And Paul describes the Word of God here as the oracles of God. In ancient civilization, oracles were simply divine sayings. So you had the Oracle of Delphi. These were supposed to be supernaturally authoritative divine sayings. But the oracles of God, those are the true divine words of God. Oracles means words. The New American Standard translates oracles, the utterances of God, in 1 Peter chapter 4, verse 11. It can refer to a narrow section. Stephen uses the term for the Mosaic Law. But most often, particularly used this way, the oracles of God were simply talking about the Scriptures, and in this case, the Old Testament Scriptures. In their entirety, are the Word of God. Even though written by men, they are the Word of God. As Paul says, for all Scripture is given by inspiration and is profitable for doctrine, reproof, correction, and instruction in righteousness. And what he says there, that the God-breathed word, which are the oracles of God, shows us something very important, that though God delivered these words through the penmanship of divinely inspired authors, what we have is as if it were the word of God's mouth. So often in Psalm 119, the psalmist will talk about the word of God's mouth. The Old Testament was God's oracle. It was God's living word. Our Bibles are God's oracle, God's living word, with all of the divine imprint and authority that comes from inspiration. And notice, the oracles were entrusted to the old covenant people. This is the distinction between special revelation and general revelation. General revelation is for the world at large. But special revelation, this was the packaging of God's word for and through His church. And you see, there's a stewardship implied then in this entrusted to the people of God. Later, in 1 Timothy chapter 3, Paul will reflect on this stewardship. After he's given instructions about elders and conducting oneself in the household of God, he says, I'm writing these things in verse 14 to you, hoping to come to you before long, but in case I'm delayed, I write so that you will know how one ought to conduct himself in the household of God, which is the church of the living God. Now notice this, the pillar and support of the truth. This is our stewardship. The scriptures are entrusted to us, and we have the guardianship of them. We have the preservation of them. We are responsible for the communication of them to the world. This is that stewardship. And this is the inestimable privilege of having the Word of God, because it's here and here alone that God shows us the depth and breadth of who He is and of His covenant. Later, when Paul picks up on this theme in Romans chapter 9, and again, one of the advantages of the Old Covenant people, he says in verse 4, who are Israelites, to whom belong the adoption as sons, the glory, the covenants, the giving of the law, the temple worship, the promises, whose are the fathers, from whom is the Christ according to the flesh, who is over all God blessed forever. That's all the message of Scripture, you see. This is God's covenant revelation that He gave to the church. Who He is, what covenant He's made with the people, what promises that He has, the law to govern them in their lives, and Christ Jesus. And it's very interesting that the phrase, as Paul writes it here, is an assertion of the full deity of the Lord Jesus Christ, which has already been revealed to the covenant people in the Old Testament. So they had this message, the wisest message. God says in Deuteronomy chapter 4, with respect again to His scriptures and the responsibility to live only by them, not to add to them or take away from them, that His people possessed in them this remarkable revelation of God. Or what great nation is there that has statutes and judgments as righteous as this whole law that I'm setting before you today? And later in Psalm 147, he compares the oracles given to Jacob with the powerful word of God in providence, in the creation of ice and snow and wind and storm. And he concludes all that in verse 19. He declares his words to Jacob, his statutes and ordinances to Israel. You see why Paul can say great in every way, in every respect. Because they have the revelation of God. They have the person of God. They have the covenant of God. And they have in prospect the Lord Jesus Christ. We have the fullness of this revelation in the Scriptures. And so we continue to answer the question, regardless of what is going on, regardless of those that will deny the truth, regardless of those that will despise the truth because of the failures of some professors and teachers, we have the Word of God. Do you cherish it? Do you love it? When you handle it, do you realize that when you sit with the Lord in the morning, you open the Word, can you say with Samuel, "Speak, Lord, your servant listens," that you're going into a one-on-one with God, taught by the Holy Spirit who indwells you. When you sit in your family and have family worship, do you realize that it's God who is speaking to you through His Word? Do you handle it with such love and care? Do you approach it with a dependence upon the Holy Spirit? We must. And not just give lip service that, oh, we believe that the Bible is the Word of God. Do you handle it as the oracles of God? And do you listen to Him? Because He will challenge you. He will reprove and rebuke you. Do you relish in the public means of grace and the preaching of God's Word? Where Christ comes to the lawfully ordained man and speaks with a living voice. And thus, as the larger catechism says, do you receive it in faith, love, meekness, readiness of mind as the Word of God? What a privilege. Children and young people, perhaps at times you wonder, what advantages do I have being in a Christian family, being in the church, a baptized member of the church of the Lord Jesus Christ? Paul says to you, my young friends, great in every way. And he highlights for you that you have the very Word of God. You live amongst the people who possess the Word of God. There's many children throughout the world that don't even have a Bible. They don't know who God is, let alone know that He actually has given a Word to us. There's probably children on your street who have never read the Bible, don't know the beautiful message of the gospel of the Lord Jesus Christ. And amongst many other privileges, young friends, that God has given to you, He has given you His Word. He's put you in the midst of the people where He has planted His Word, and He presses this Word upon you. He makes great promises to you in this Word. He says, I will be your God. He has had you baptized with His water of baptism. But He would say, don't be like the Jews. Don't stop there. Don't look at the water of baptism. No, He presses upon you the claims of the Lord Jesus Christ so that you will take hold of Christ in the covenant as your own Savior. And of course, parents then, if there are these advantages in the covenant, how careful and diligent you must be in rearing your children in the Word of God. With family worship and instruction, scripture and catechetical memorization, having them in the catechism and Sunday school classes of the church, having them under the preaching of the Word, not tucked off somewhere in the basement of the church, that they might hear Christ speak with a living voice. Nurture them. Press upon them these covenant privileges. Press upon them. Teach them then how to handle the Word for themselves so that they will grow up feeding on Christ through His Word. So the unbelief of the Jews and the unbelief of people today and the departure of the faith in no way nullifies God's covenant privileges and benefits, the first of which we have the Word of God. Second, Paul says, it does not nullify God's faithfulness. Now, you can see where he's going with this, with these questions. As he begins verse 3, what then? I say, all right, they have the Word of God. They have all of this revelation, words and statutes and judgments that no other nation of the earth had. But what did they do with it? They had Christ placarded from Genesis 3:15 through Malachi. So what? They rejected Christ. They did not take hold of Him. They stayed in their formalism. And they rejected the Savior whom God sent. And so the second question that Paul frames then in verse 3 is, If some did not believe, their unbelief will not nullify the faithfulness of God, will it? May it never be. Rather, let God be found true, though every man be found a liar, as it is written, that you may be justified in your words and prevail when you are judged. Now, in the very asking, the framing of the question, Paul already begins to answer his question in two ways. In the first place, this is a rhetorical question that demands a negative answer. So the very way that he's phrased the question, he is saying, no way. If some did not believe, their unbelief will not nullify the faithfulness of God, will it? And the question demands an emphatic no, it will not. But notice it well as he frames the question, if some did not believe. You see, he's already anticipating the important truth that he is going to lay out in chapter 9. When again he comes back, has God's word failed? Is God unfaithful? No, because all those who have descended from Israel are not Israel. And there he teaches then the sovereignty of God and the salvation of covenant people. And so the word some here is very important. It's not that all rejected the Lord Jesus Christ. And Paul will say in chapter 9 that election works through the covenant. Now, I think this addresses what I think is a serious error that's in some places in our community these days. And that is that as long as you faithfully teach your children, they're all going to come to Christ. So I don't think God promises that. I think that God has promised to be a God to us and our seed. But I've yet to find a promise in the Bible he'll save every one of our children. We plead with him to do so. We have grand promises. We'll rest on them. We'll press Christ on our children. And we'll claim prayerfully those promises. But some, Paul says, will not believe. Does that make God unfaithful to his promise? Does that mean the promise has failed? Or has God put all that weight on the back of a sinful parent to guarantee the conversion of their child? No way. No way. So the very framing of the question, Paul begins to answer it. But then notice the emphatic answer in verse 4. He begins with, may it never be. One of the strongest ways that the Bible ever rejects something. The King James translates it, God forbid, it's blasphemy to think such a thing. May it never be. I, as a teenager, heard a sermon from actually, he was a neo-Orthodox professor at Columbia Seminary, but it was a great gospel sermon, and it was on one of these passages, and the Greek is megenetoi. I tell you guys not to use Greek, but I remember that sermon today because the man talked a lot about megenetoi. Let it not be. Let it not be. God forbid. Paul is asserting with this assertion that God is never unfaithful. He then states it positively. Rather, let God be found true, though every man be found a liar. If the whole world falls away, if a whole raft of faithful, experimental, covenantal preachers apostatize, God is true. Let every man and woman in the world be a liar if that's what is necessary. God is true. God is faithful. He's a rock, as he says in Deuteronomy chapter 32. He's our rock. He is unchanging. And thus, everything he reveals in Scripture, every doctrine, every commandment, every promise, every threatening is faithful and true. So you might have to be like Athanasius, who was called contra mundum, Athanasius against the world, because the majority opinion was against the full deity of the Lord Jesus Christ. And yet, by God's grace, he didn't waver. Or like Luther at Worms, when the empire and all of the machinery of the papacy stood against him. He pled conscience that he must stand upon the word of God. Let all of them be liars. God is true. God's word is true. And Paul then affirms that with a quotation, rather strange, from David's confession in Psalm 51, verse 4. As it is written, that you may be justified in your words and prevail when you are judged. Now, he quotes here from the Greek translation of this psalm, which takes the last phrase and puts it in the passive, that God may prevail when he is judged. Now, in David's confession, after his horrendous sin of adultery and military murder, he says in verse 4, against you, you only I have sinned and done what is evil in your sight, so that you are justified when you speak and blameless when you judge. Now, the Septuagint takes this last part and says that you are blameless or you prevail when you are judged. I think what David is saying here, as Paul is adding this further interpretation to it, is that when God has severely chastened me in my sin, God is not to be judged. God shall prevail. My confession of my sin being against God only exalts God and abases me, says David. And so that's how Paul is applying this here, is that when God judges, he's judging sinners. He's judging according to his faithful revelation. And in his very judgment then, he himself shall not be judged. He is faithful. And his faithfulness is maintained in his judgment, so that he is impeccable, unspeakably righteous in his judgments. And so what Paul is saying is that God's not unfaithful. The old covenant people who failed to come to Christ were unfaithful. And he would be saying, remember that with covenant blessings, there were covenant curses. And just opposed to promises, there were threatenings. And just as God keeps every promise, God keeps every threat. And God's faithfulness is demonstrated in as much as in the destruction of the temple in 70 AD as it was in the conversion of Saul of Tarsus. Both acts, demonstration of the faithfulness of God. And so in the old covenant, when some of them, even relatively speaking, the great majority of them then refused to take hold of Christ, they clung to their formalistic, hypocritical religion, it did not nullify God's word, covenant privileges, God's faithfulness. And you see then how we come back full circle in this as we gather this week again to be instructed in and revel in the teachings of Martin Luther and the great solas of the Reformation, in spite of the fact that we have witnessed and we will witness until the return of Christ heartbreaking defections that shall shatter us and shall bring dishonor to God, as David did, and thus he suffered more severely in his chastening because he dragged God's name through the mud. But God's on a throne, and God's truth is not judged by men's reaction or abuse of it. God stands behind his truth. Let God be true and every man a liar. And thus you must not despair, and you must not fret. You are to pray for the families and the churches of the people involved. You are to be mindful, so mindful, dear friends, take heed to yourself. Let him who thinks he stands, be carefully not fall. And you're mindful of the fact, and this is the Phoenix doctrine of God's sovereignty. All things work together for good to those who love God and are called according to his purpose. And all things, yes, are the tragedies of your life, the cancer, the loss of a loved one, a car accident, the lost job, but all things are your sin. All things are the sins of leaders in the church of the Lord Jesus Christ. And God, the great alchemist, is going to take everything, as he did from the first fall, which he ordained, everything shall be turned to his glory, to the furtherance of Christ's kingdom, and to the well-being of his people and his church. Let us pray. Almighty God in heaven, we bless you and praise your name for the Spirit's wisdom unfolded here as the apostle anticipates these objections to his indictment of the covenant people. Timeliness of the comfort for us, and we thank you for it. Let us rest in Christ, in him alone. Let us know that your promises will be kept, as well as your threatenings. If there's one here this day who's playing games with you, trusting in covenant privilege, trusting in outward blessing, thinking all is well, let them hear this message not as an encouragement, but as a dire warning. They must repent and take hold of the Lord Jesus Christ. Let all of us, Lord, know the comfort of your sovereign faithfulness revealed in your word. We ask this for Christ's sake. Amen.